the pines, in the pines where the sun never shines, you'll shiver when the cold wind blows. There's a grave in the pines where the sun never shines, there's a grave that's shaded with the pines.
Hi, this is Joe Scavarina, local author and historian. We're back in Step Back in Time, our program on history, and we thank Nine Star Connect for giving us this opportunity. We're in Pendleton, Indiana today, historic Pendleton. This sign here was placed in 1966 by the Pendleton Lions Club, and Pendleton was founded in 1823, and it served as the county seat of Madison County until 1825. It's the oldest town in Madison County. Near this spot, the first white child was born in 1820. The first marriage took place in 1821. The courthouse, the Madison County Courthouse and Jail, was here in Pendleton in 1823. Frederick Douglass, the famous abolitionist, was assaulted here in 1843 as he spoke about the abolition of slavery. Stone was taken for quarries and culverts on the National Road from this spot. Pendleton wasn't incorporated until 1854. It was also known as Falls City and Pendleton Courthouse, but it finally stuck the name of Thomas Pendleton, the first guy that lived here. The Madison County was incorporated in 1823 at the home of William McCartney on Main and Water Street here in town. And for the longest time, until 1827, Madison and Hancock County were one county. And in 1828, Hancock County became one of its own. Come with me and we'll go in the museum. We're here in the historic Pendleton Museum, and tell us about this. This is Nancy Noel, the president of his museum here. Tell us a little bit about this building and everything.
A little history on the museum. The building is located in what used to be the bathhouse for the pool, which was the creek several years ago, and it closed in the late 60s. The museum itself was opened in 1981 after the community people added the second floor and added new walls and exterior and flooring. This year, Indiana celebrates its 200th anniversary, and the museum decided to participate by recognizing 19 former residents from the area, and so we have our 19 stars. And throughout the museum, you will find special exhibits on those 19 individuals. If you'll come this way, we'll take a walking tour of the museum. Here we have an exhibit pertaining to the park, and B.F. Phipps is one of our original 19 that we recognized, and he was a town board member who proposed the idea to make a swimming pool and a park here in the early 1920s. And this is an exhibit of what the park was like then and how people really came to use the pool. And you'll see that they used to ice skate on the pond around the lighthouse. And that they no longer let that freeze over, but as late as the 50s and early 60s, people were still ice skating there. Now on this wall, we begin our area that pertains to the agriculture community around Pendleton. And you'll see some drawings of Pendleton as it looked in the late 1800s, and the grain elevators, and used to have quite an industry in farming and agriculture. We had several gas wells in the area. And here you see some veterinary equipment and farming equipment. We have an old wooden water main and a sleigh. We like to show students when they come on tour how people lived in the late 1800s and early 1900s. We have a large grain grinder. So I'd like to introduce you to Bob Bilby. Bob is the treasurer of the Pendleton Historical Museum, and he's going to explain some of the farming equipment.
Yes, as you can see, we have a pump, an old wooden pump that they used to pump water out of a well. And we have the harness, stitching harness for repairing. A lot of wood equipment, lard presses. Up on the wall here, we have some of the items that they would use to with horse or cattle to pull wagons and stuff. And then you get into a little bit of a carpentry pieces, and we've got a mixture of them with the mixed in with the farm, because in most cases it would go hand in hand. So we have a lot of small tools that they would use. We have a lard press, we have a cabbage shredder. You run your cabbage through there and make it into a lot smaller pieces. You got a copper pan nailed down here that they would use for boiling, maybe for lard or something from the hog or the cattle. Oil. Gosh, that got right back here. We've got repairs for your shoes, boots, whatever might have to be worked on. They had to use everything that they could as long as they could, till they finally just had to throw it away. On down here, we do have, here's a little oil container. This is a bucket that they would put milk in from a mother cow, and then they would feed it to the calves through there. And this is also would be the same thing, although it's in a bottle form. This is a lard press where they, when they butcher, they would have a press to use the lard from the animals too. Down here you can see where we have a combine, and there used to be a huge combine of the equipment that the farmers in this area would use. You have the as they call them. This little item right here, this upside down glass unit, would be a water to feed chickens or turkeys or whatever kind of fowl you might have in the farm. That's about the extent of the farming equipment.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bob. One of the things I'd like to point out is the large sycamore grain bin here. They have one in Indianapolis at the Indiana Museum, and they would carve it out, and then they would store grain in there for the cattle or whatever animals they had to feed during the winter. And then this is an oxen yoke here, and then we have sausage grinders. And this happens to be a horseradish grinder. I know.
I have to come up here and grind my horseradish.
Right, yes. If you grow a lot of horseradish, bring it here, by all means. Okay, I'd like to introduce you to Suzanne Hagen, who will talk about this area.
Thank you, Nancy. This area, we spent a lot of time this year going up in the attic and trying to better organize our yearbooks, and so we have from 1916 on as far as yearbooks, and people can come in and visit and sit down, and then we have a little shelf that someone built for us that we can just pull this out and people can put the yearbook here or any of our historical books that are mainly Madison County historical books. There's the Pendleton Times, all of the, a lot of the earlier newspapers, a lot of early historical books, and they're welcome to look through them and put them here. So also, over here where the farm exhibit was above that, we have a lot of antique guns. And the second one from the top is a Civil War gun with the bayonet on the end. It looks pretty brutal. And then some of the others, we have some older guns. This one, the second from the bottom, wasn't cleaned very well. And so when they used it, it blew the side out. And I understand that the person lost his finger. We also have a little store here that we sell some things, historical things, and also then over here we have some more things. And then the pictures on the wall are some of the earlier pictures of the museum and so forth. Some of them are pencil drawings, some of them are paintings, and some of them, though this one is the falls. So we're really proud of what we have. Okay, and then over here, we have a sign that's Tankies. It was a drugstore, and it was kind of a hangout for people. They had like a soda area and all that, and then a couple doctors from Pendleton, and we have their pictures up there. They, we have a lot of equipment that came from those offices and all. So some things you might recognize today, some things you won't recognize at all. And then also we have a lot of antique eyeglasses that I found pretty interesting. Some of them look like what people wear today, and I find that to be real interesting. We also have a nurse's cape. That's the kind of cape that nurses wore many years ago. We also had one of the doctors, Dr. McLaughlin, was a good doctor. He went door to door to people's homes and all, and especially people that were really sick and couldn't get out. And then we also have just some other equipment that were really the top of the line back in the day. And then we also have an examining chair that was loaned to us by Bob Pendleton.
I noticed you have a lot of fossils here on the wall. Were these all collected here in Madison County?
No.
Okay. They're all Indiana fossils, though, aren't they?
Right. They're Indiana, but they aren't particularly collected here in this area.
Okay. I see that now.
And we have a few over here in this case also. We have different sizes. I believe that a lot of these are from the area, the larger stones below, working tools. And we also have a really nice organ that I have heard people play it. It's a pump organ, so it would be a form of exercise besides being able to use it.
There's a picture of Frederick Douglass up there. Tell me about him and Pendleton.
He came to visit a few times. He was real interested in the community because there are a lot of
friends.
I couldn't remember the name. A lot of friends and a lot of Quaker families. And so when he came one time, he was stoned and beaten up pretty bad, and the Quakers took him in, nursed him back to health, and he came back several times because he was so grateful of how friendly the community was.
He was a slave that was free, that was an abolitionist, right?
Right, okay. Right. And so then we have William Walker that graduated from Pendleton. I believe it was 1915. He went on to Hollywood. He became a member of the Screen Actors Guild and actually was president of the Screen Actors Guild. And if you look at the pictures, you'll see a lot of movies and so forth that he was in. When he died, his family donated a lot of this things to us, and people really do enjoy looking through it and seeing it. And then we have some pictures down below here also of some of the movies he was in and so forth. And he did come back many times and spoke at high school graduations. Some of the people you'll probably recognize in the pictures. And then we have Verna Whitworth, that is a local celebrity. She had a radio show, and she did it from her house. And school kids would come in and be on the radio with her and sing with her. She would sing songs, and then they would sing with her. And she was pretty busy. We also, we did have some recordings. I'm not for certain that we still have any of her. We have this player piano that the kids really enjoy, and I should say some of the adults do also. And then we have a good selection of music. This is kind of considered our music room. And so we have a lot of instruments, a lot of older records, and so forth. We also have some things of Dr. White, and this is some of his things here, some of his books, and a lot of articles about him.
Dr. White is one of the 19 stars that we're recognizing. He came to Pendleton when he went to work for the reformatory. And he worked with the prisoners at the reformatory, and he thought education was a good way for them to improve their lives. And they named the room, the library there, after Dr. White. And when they receive their diplomas, if they graduate from there, it has Dr. White's name on it. And he called Pendleton home until he passed away. He was at one time Lions Club's oldest living member. He died in his hundreds, and he was quite an asset to the town of Pendleton. If you come through here, we'll go into what we call the schoolroom. And Jan Fox is our resident expert on the schools of Pendleton and the area. So Jan Fox, would you talk to them about that?
I will. If we could start on this side, we've tried to kind of divide the schoolroom into maybe the sports area and then the school pictures. A few years ago, the museum graciously began accepting Markleville memorabilia from Adams Township. Originally, there were two high schools in South Madison, Markleville and Pendleton. And in 1967, the state mandated that they needed to consolidate. So the consolidation took place. The first graduating class was 1970. Pendleton and Markleville consolidated and created Pendleton Heights. So we have some Markleville memorabilia here. We've tried to create different displays. A few years ago, we realized that just because we remembered Pendleton Heights, a lot of the students that came in our school tours didn't realize that we needed the Pendleton Heights memorabilia. So we are trying to gradually collect more of that. There were two other schools that fed into these high schools. Fall Creek, which was built in 1924, had grades 1 through 8, and then they went to Markleville. Ingalls had the same thing, and their children were filtered into Pendleton. So you had 4 grade schools and junior highs that went to the 2 separate high schools. We've collected some things. These are the theater seats from the Pendleton Middle School auditorium that was removed a few years ago, and we got to collect those. Here is our first shining star. Dick Dickey was a 1944 graduate of Pendleton High School. He went on to play with the Boston Celtics. Up here are just different pictures of the various teams. If you look at their attire, the way they played football is certainly different than all of the equipment and helmets and things that they have now. This is our showcase that has some of the trophies and memorabilia of the music department. The Pendleton Irishettes in 1966 were national champions. Then also, it's a tradition that I don't believe they do anymore. They were called senior chords, and our most recent was 1968. When you were a senior, they called them senior chords because they painted on either the pants or the skirts, and it was corduroy material. So if you were an artist, you could generate some income with the seniors because they wore those with pride. But I believe 68's the last class we have. We've tried to incorporate some of the athletic memorabilia with our classroom. This area maybe would depict, when we do the school tours, the children are always interested in this. We show them how they've gone from the age of having your slate that you wrote on with chalk and the desks that were hooked together. The old lunch box would be totally different than the packaged lunches a lot of them receive now. Our mannequin here would depict maybe what your school teacher would look like. This bell is what was the original bell from an Adams Township school. The children would walk to school. They tried to have the schools be about a mile apart because that's the transportation the children had. And that bell was rung at an Adams Township school to tell the children to hurry up and get to class. So one of our oldest pictures that we have of the class is 1893, and it is amazing that those have survived. And then we have some 1900s pictures. And again, you can see the different attire that they wore, the way their hair was, the number of children in the class. This is the original school bell from Pendleton High School North Building, 1895 to 1937. So we feel very fortunate to have that also. We have over here in our sports section, you might have already got our, we have the mascot uniform and Jeff Umbles, and he still is a resident of the area. This is what he wore when he was the mascot. The Pendleton High School mascot, they were the Irish, and so this was a leprechaun uniform. Markleville High School, their mascot was the Arabian horse. We have various trophies that people have donated. I think we're finding now that generations are passing on and they don't know what to do with these things, and it's very fortunate that we're able to have a place to house them. Don Hankins is another one of our 19 stars. He ended up, he was a baseball player with, I can't remember. 19, he had a broken elbow, but then they said he'd probably not be able to play again, and then he played 11 seasons in the Detroit Tigers. These are kind of some of the old lockers, and we've hung some memorabilia and depict what the uniforms looked like. Here again, we have old class sweaters from various people. We have the first yearbook of the new high school. And they were able to take class trips. That's a class trip of 1941. And I know at Markleville, everyone really looked forward to that. They went to Washington, D.C. And you saved money and sold concessions and worked real hard. And at that time, that was the first and maybe only time that a lot of the people were able to go on a trip like that. They took buses, and it was a very exciting time for them. This is kind of a signboard. When people come in, we've tried to depict various pictures, and there's some pictures of Markleville High School and some history there, and then we also have some of the Pendleton schools. Then one of my favorite things about being on the museum board is the tours of the schools, and we usually do those in the fall, and the children come through, and it's amazing some of the things that catch their interest and the questions that they have.
Are the old schools torn down?
Markleville School, High School is still up, and Reflectix bought that building, and they manufacture the Reflectix insulation, and that, it's amazing, in little tiny town Markleville, that is sold worldwide. Mm-hmm. Pendleton, was that 2 years ago, Nancy, that it was torn down? They felt like they needed it for parking. Fall Creek School has been remodeled by a construction company, and I'm not sure what Ingalls School.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you, Jan. If we'll go along this way, we'll go up the back stairway to the second floor. And on the way up the stairs, we'll take a look at some of the exhibits in the stairwell.
Can you get me the elevator?
Here you'll see, this is dedicated to when Idlewild was the name of the golf course. It's now the Fall Creek Golf Course. But when it was first established, it had cabins and an area for swimming and boating. And so we dedicated an exhibit to it. And it backs up to the reformatory in Pendleton. Then we have a group of paintings by William McVall. He was a Pendleton graduate in 1927. And they're quite fine paintings of various birds. And then as you come on around the corner, we just have some paintings by local artists in the community. As you come up to the second floor, we'll start in this corner. First, we have an exhibit on Homer Motzinger, a Pendleton person who had at least 20 patents, most of them in the automotive area, but he was known for the auto sparker. He had a plant, several little factories here in town, and he sponsored various things. Then we have some several railroads used to run through Pendleton, so we have lanterns from the railroads. This large coal stove was from one of the train stations at the time. And then we have several things depicting the interurban ran through Pendleton. And so we have some rails, wheels there from the interurban and some pictures of the interurban. We have, well, there were two railroad stations at one different times in Pendleton, one right in town and one that was rather high up where the train tracks still run. We have an exhibit on the old fire station. It's still a volunteer fire department, and it's located in what used to be a livery building. And then we'll go into our military area. We have a what's considered a rather nice collection of Civil War through the Iraq War of uniforms and memorabilia from those wars. This case mostly is from the Civil War. Hanging on the wall here, these are duplicates, but we have the original of the mustering out records of Captain Elijah Williams, the 89th Regiment of the Indiana that fought in the Civil War. And many names are still families located in Pendleton that fought in the Civil War and the 89th Regiment. But those are the copies of the front and back of the mustering out record. A descendant of Elijah Williams gave that to us. And as you come around here, you'll see an exhibit. This happens to be from the Vietnam War, that uniform. And then we have them from World War II, along here, the Korean War. And then we have an Indiana National Guard uniform. And various pictures hang about. Most of the uniforms we have the picture of the person who wore the uniform. And these are people who are from the area. In the center here, we just put some on display, and we happen to have the uniform there on the left of Robert Miller. He was in World War II, and around the corner there on the display mannequin is his son's uniform from the Vietnam War. And you go around, you'll see the various uniforms and the various services. We have all of them covered. And we had some local women who served in the military as nurses in World War II. And this is Belle Fuller's uniform. She was a nurse in World War II. And in this case over here, We have uniforms from the Civil War and from World War I, and some of their memorabilia. Then we come around the corner here, we have a television that was a kit, and a gentleman that lived in Huntsville made the kit and had it ready for the Indianapolis 500, the only time the 500 was shown locally live. And so everybody gathered around this little TV to watch the 500.
You know what? I remember my first television at home was that size.
Really?
Yeah.
Next to it, we have a display of various photography equipment and viewfinders that through the years, it's just kind of interesting to see. Now most people carry their camera on their phone. But it was quite an art at one time. Then we just have an exhibit of homes, pictures of homes in the area that lots of people like to come and see if they can find their home or a picture of their home as it used to be. At one time, we had a special display on General Motors and Guide Lamp because most of the people around here seem to have jobs connected to those two factories when they were in Anderson. And then we have some on the history of the reformatory, which is an important aspect of Pendleton.
How long has the reformatory been here?
Well, it was built in the 20s. Mm-hmm. They moved it up here because we had so many trains, railroad tracks that came into mm-hmm. the area. And Dillinger was a prisoner at the reformatory at one time. So we don't have a lot, but we have a little bit. And then we have a few factories. Okay, as you come on around here, we have a small collection of toys that children played with as back in the early 1900s. And a lot of people might still remember this machine where you would put a penny in the top and where it landed would be how much money you actually got to spend. The dime store used to have that. You'd put a penny in and you might get 3 cents worth of candy when it got where depending on where it landed. And then we come into what we kind of call our church area. And we don't have a great deal on the various churches, but we have some old marriage licenses and songbooks and different things that came from some local churches. It's a small part of our display. And now we're into what we start as like family living. And Judy Tesher, our secretary of the board, will explain this area to you.
Yes, this is the everyday life. And the first thing I want to point out is this little dress right here. The school children, when they come, love to see this because when you tell them that little boys wore dresses, they don't believe you. And so I did a little research on why they wore dresses, and it's because in the 17th century, babies died, and they didn't really value them that much. They just wrapped them up and swaddled them so that they couldn't get in fires and stuff. And most of the children died. And so in the 1800s, when Queen Victoria became queen in England, she started the trend of dressing babies in regular clothing. So they had no past history of little boys wearing pants. And so we have a collection of some of the clothes that babies wore and some of the buggies and different things that you would have had back then. Instead of plastic, you had wood or wicker. And then we come into the weaving area. This is a barn loom that was in Madison County. I'm not sure where in Madison County, but we've ended up with it. And they made coverlets and fabric for clothing out of flax and wool on there. And then we do have, and I'm really proud of this, a collection of coverlets by Samuel Hicks. Samuel Hicks came to this area in the early 1800s, and he left Pennsylvania because the Jacquard loom was taking his business away. He was still doing it manually on one of these bigger looms, and it technology forced him to move over here, move to Indiana and start his own business. And he is a very collectible and well-known coverlet maker. And then if you come on around the corner, we have a wonderful bed that was donated to us by the Mingle family. And the children, when they come through, absolutely love to look at the top of the headboard. It looks like there's a fox there. And coming around, we have some different examples of washing machines that you didn't have to go work out back then at the local gym, because you got your workout right here with the iron. And the irons are that you heat on the stove are very heavy, so they had plenty of weightlifting and aerobic exercise, just doing their daily work. We have two examples of refrigerators. One is an actual wooden ice box. It's where the man came and delivered ice every day. The second one is a white GE that was purchased in 1930. It cost over $300, and it was probably the first refrigerator in Pendleton. We're sure that it was the first in Huntsville, but we don't know for sure about Pendleton. And it belonged to the Mercer family, and they had 10 children, and they used it up to 1960s, and it still works. And then we have an example of a warm morning stove, which was kind of the beginning of a furnace in a home. And then on the far side of the cabinet, then there's a little tiny cooking stove, heating stove. And then over to this side, if you could find it, we have some examples of early carpet sweepers. And I think it's interesting, they kind of look like today. But of course, they're not electric, and you had to pump them. So again, it was a lot of physical labor just to do the everyday chores. Another thing that the children love is this permanent hair permanent machine. I don't know what to call it exactly, but the person would sit underneath it, and these things would all be heated up and plastered on their hair. And people have come through that remember having this done to them as a child and remember hair being burnt off, and it looks very dangerous, doesn't it? And then coming on through the parlor area, when the children come through, they love the telephones on the back wall there. They're just amazed by the size of the big wooden ones. And they have no concept of a rotary phone. And it's getting to the point where even the touch tones, the children don't recognize. And I actually have a cell phone that I think I'm going to come bring in and put in the collection, because even old cell phones look strange to kids today. And I'll hand it back off to Nancy.
Thank you. If you'll come over this way, you'll see a display from the Pendleton Post Office. The clock is from the original Pendleton Post Office. And Kenny Lukens was our first walking mail carrier. And this is his uniform. And we have still in the exhibit, in the current post office, a painting on the wall that was created during the time when Roosevelt put people to work, and We have one of the remaining, I think there are 30-some paintings in the state of Indiana that are still have murals in their post offices, and this is one of them. And in the case below, we have some of the 19 that we recognized. Lloyd Lewis was a Pendleton person, and he went on to be one of the editors of the Chicago Tribune and wrote several books. A lot of people around this area would know Keith Bulin. He held lots of positions in politics, but he was mainly helped other politicians get elected. And then we have Paulina Gaither Lafuse. She and her husband both graduated from Pendleton, and they left the area and went to California. And they became, she especially became known for her work in saving the San Bernardino area. And then the last person I would like to point out is Maud Ward. And Maud Ward pioneered Indiana into being one of the few states that worked in the prevention of blindness. But also for Pendleton, she was one of the founders of the Pendleton Historic Fall Creek Pendleton Settlement.
Easy for you to say.
It's not easy for me to say. And that little crooked building there was presented to that group because Pendleton and Madison, Indiana, were the only two cities who had their town designated as a historic district.
Okay, yeah. And that's the Bert Savas Award.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
So, I thank you for coming today.
Well, thank you for having us. It was an interesting thing. I think the next thing we're going to go is go see the site of the massacre at Fall Creek.
Okay, it's just across the bridge
it
from
is.
Here.
Yep, and thank you. Who was all these people were here today? Can you
They were
them?
All board members, Jan Fox, Suzanne Hagen, Judy Tesher, and Bob Bilby. And we're open May through October, Saturdays and Sundays, 1 to 5. So we invite everyone to come. And
does it cost
visit.
To get in?
Everything we do is free, except for our chicken and noodle dinner.
Well, that's a fundraiser, right?
That's
when is
right.
That?
It is the first, it's always the first Friday in May, and it's right next door at the community building.
First Friday in May. Don't forget it. First Friday in
that's
May.
That's right. $7, and we have carry out. So
okay.
We invite you to that also.
Nancy, thank you for your time.
Thank you for coming. All and. Right. Have a good day.
Thank you.
You'll enjoy the trip through the park because it's beautiful out there
it
today.
It is today. Yep.
So,
thank you.
Thank you.
Here we're back here at the Pendleton Historical Museum. We're right here at the falls at Fall Creek. And I'm with Bob Post and Steve Jackson. Steve Jackson is the official Madison County historian. Mr. Post, you said you were a lifeguard here at one time. Tell me about that.
Yes, the year that the swimming pool closed, I was the head lifeguard here. 4th of July, we had over 2,000 people pay to swim, which would really affect the park budget today if we could get this open and get that many people to come back in.
Why'd they close this?
There were health concerns. You know, I got used to getting strep throat, but other people didn't, and so they shut it down.
I'm with Steve Jackson, the official Madison County historian, and Jasmine West wrote a book called The Massacre at Fall Creek, and it was about this area. There might be a little misnomer about some of that, but I want you to go over there and show us the place where these guys were hung and tell us a little bit about it. Will you do that?
We'll sure
and
do that.
And Bob will go with you.
We'll sure do that.
Okay, thank you.
Probably the most important event that occurred here in Pendleton that actually put Pendleton on the map was a hanging that took place in this park in June of 1825. But the events that led up to that hanging are what make it so interesting and a compelling story to tell. Madison County had become a county in 1823, so it was newly formed. The Native Americans that had lived here had been moved out by treaty, last of them leaving in 1821, but there was a scattering of a few Native Americans still in the area, and that's what caused this story to happen. In March of 1824, about 10 miles east of here on a creek known as Deer Lick Creek, there were encamped some Seneca and another group of Indians, all under the direction of a Native American by the name of Chief Logan. And on Monday morning in that march, there were a group of townsmen from the Ovid area, New Columbus, and others who had decided that those Indians shouldn't be there. If you look into the history of some of the men, they had had family members that had been victims of Indian raids back in Pennsylvania. So there was a bitterness in their heart over the Indians that were here. And the Sunday night before they went over there on Monday morning, they got pretty well liquored up in a local tavern. Went over there early on a Monday morning. There were 10 Native Americans camped there peacefully, minding their own business along Deer Lick Creek. The men walked into the camp supposedly on the pretense that they had lost some horses. Could the Indians come and help them find them? So several of the male members of the group that was there went with them separate directions, and while they were out and gone, the men murdered them. They then returned to the camp and proceeded to murder the rest of the people that were there at the camp, mainly women and children. One survived and was able to get away and did survive, but a total of 9 Indians were massacred on that early March morning in 1824. Well, the perpetrators went back home and began to brag about what they had done, and of course that alerted Madison County Sheriff Corey to come down and investigate the crime, and they arrested those perpetrators. Word had come down from Washington, D.C. Word had reached Washington, D.C. of this crime, and the officials in Washington, D.C. said to the local officials here, namely the Indian agent that was in charge, a man by the name of Johnston, said to them, you need to try and bring justice to the perpetrators, because we're afraid that with Madison County just recently being developed, that there will be a reprisal of some Indians that are in the area. They'll come back for revenge, and what we're trying to do is settle that area, encourage people to move in, and that will unsettle everything. So there was a great effort to bring those people to trial. And so it wasn't until later in the fall of 1822 that trial occurred. That trial took place downstream here in Pendleton. Now in 1824, the Madison County Courthouse was located here in Pendleton. Pendleton was the county seat of Madison County in 1824, and the trial took place in the old two-room courthouse that was located across Fall Creek and down today what is the corner of Water Street and Main Street in Pendleton. There were 4 men that were charged, 3 men and a boy, the boy being the son of one of the perpetrators. Each one received a separate trial. Each one had a verdict of guilty rendered by the jury that was impaneled to hear the trial. And the judge set the sentence as being execution. And so that was to be carried out first in November of 1824, but there was some problems getting that arranged, and so it wasn't until later in January 1825 that the first of the 4 was hung. And he was brought here to this site that you see over here on the hillside. History doesn't record for us whether there was a scaffolding or they hung him from a tree or just what, but it was on the site that's in the background here behind me that has the stone that's marking it as the site for the white men that were hung here for killing Indians. The first man was hung in January of 1824, and then the other 3 were not scheduled to be hung until January of 1825. The other 3 were not scheduled to be hung until June of 1825, and on that appointed day, all 3 of them were brought here in the back of a wagon. They crossed the creek at a ford somewhere, we don't know where, but they pulled the wagon up on this hillside behind me. And the way that the If there had been a gallows for the first hanging, it was gone. The second hanging took place this way. The men were pulled up in a wagon. The wagon was pulled up on the hillside and then chalked, and placed beneath the wheels of the wagon were planks of wood, so that when the wagon was released, it would roll down the hill quickly, and the men who were on the back of the wagon would be plunged to their death. The wagon itself was tethered to a pole that was up on the hillside, and at the appointed time, the rope was cut, wagon rolled down the hill, and the victim went off into eternity. The first two adults were executed, and they were laid in coffins in front of the wagon, and the third culprit was brought up. He was the son of one of the first two, and at the time of the crime, he was 17 years old. By now, he's 18 years old, and through testimony of all those involved, it was apparent that the boy was a witness but not a participant in that massacre. And so, but yet he was tried and found to be guilty and sentenced to be executed. But at the very last moment, when he's on the back of the wagon and the noose is placed around his neck, through Falls Park, now this is drama, at high drama, through Falls Park comes a rider on a horse. And he's waving a piece of paper and he's hollering at all those assembled here behind me, stop, stop, stop. And they heard him, they did stop, and when he rode up, it was the governor of Indiana, Governor Ray, and he had a stay of execution for the young boy. You talk about arriving in the nick of time, he sure did. The noose was taken off the neck of the young boy. He was freed. And as we've learned over the years, we think he moved to Shelby County, Indiana, and we think at least on one occasion he did return to the site, because not only was his father and the other two perpetrators that were hung here, they were buried in the cemetery just north of here in unmarked graves, and today we don't know where those graves are. In 1975, an author by the name of Jessamine West wrote a book entitled Massacre on Fall Creek, and it was a historical novel. It was gained wide attention, widely read. I would recommend it. It's a very good read. But the misnomer for this massacre was from the title of her book, Massacre on Fall Creek. Well, the massacre actually took place on what was called Deer Lake Creek, but the trial and the execution took place on Fall Creek. And what makes this so significant is that this was the first time in United States history that white men were executed for the killing of Indians. That had never happened before since we had become the United States. That had never happened before until here. A story is told that on the hillside behind me were invited a number of Native Americans who were still present in the area to witness these executions in June. And so that hillside, we're told, was lined with Indians, a lot of them Seneca, to witness the execution. And when the executions were over, they just calmly got back on their horses and began to ride away. But one of them was overheard to make the comment that they thought that the white man's justice seemed unusually too cruel. And that is the story of the execution here in Falls Park in Pendleton that made this a national site of interest all across the United States. Behind me is an old bridge abutment for a railroad that used to run through here. The stones were quarried from the pond that is adjacent to me here. What makes this significant is that this was the first railroad in Madison County. It arrived from Indianapolis here in Pendleton in December of 1851. The railroad was the Indianapolis Belle Fountain Railroad, ran from Indianapolis to Belle Fountain, Ohio. And its first leg of the journey ended here at Pendleton, where the rails stopped in December of 1851. And it was at that point that the engineers had to decide, I'm talking about the construction engineers, had to decide how they were going to cross this chasm. There was a couple of options. One was to fill this area in with fill and make a short bridge over the creek for the railroad to pass over, or secondly, to build a big long bridge that would entirely span the chasm. That's the choice that they made, and to get it elevated enough, they built this abutment behind me, which behind that is the old grade of the railroad track from the town of Pendleton that came out to this point. From here, it went across the creek and then made its way to Anderson. The bridge that they erected here was a covered wooden bridge, and at the time that it was erected, it was the longest covered railroad bridge in Indiana. And it stood on this site, probably built winter of 1851, 1852, because by June of 1852, the railroad is making its way to Anderson. So we know the bridge was in. This covered bridge stood here till the 1870s when it was replaced by a 6-span iron bridge. That iron bridge was in operation here until it was moved about a quarter of a mile east of here in 1910 to its current location, and today it's part of the CSX Railroad. But this is would be the oldest bridge abutment in Madison County.
I'm Bob Post, member of Historic Fall Creek Pendleton Settlement. We've had facade grants over a number of years. This home is one of the homes that got a facade grant several years ago. This home was built by A.B. Taylor, and there's some conjecture about the date, but at one time working on this house, I found 1895 painted on a rafter up in the attic, and so I'm dating it 1895. In the 1870s and 80s, Taylor was an important influence in the town of Pendleton. He owned a lumber business, was president of the Pendleton Window Glass Company, speculated in real estate, built another building on down the street here on the east side of Pendleton Avenue. Right now it's owned by the family, Matt and Jen Roberts and their children, and they've dreamed about owning this home for a number of years, and it finally came to pass. They saw a for sale sign in the yard, stopped and immediately purchased the house. This home is called the Gray Goose Inn. It was built approximately 1835. It's Ron and Ruth Burline had lived in Huntsville, Indiana. They had wanted this house. They fell in love with it. Eventually, they were able to purchase this home. They've done a tremendous restoration of this property. They truly love it. They furnished it with period furniture. It's hard to find something made before 1835 that would fit in here, but Ron and Ruth have traveled the country and brought back tremendous treasures to make their home appropriate to what their desires are. When our historic organization was founded, Sandy Butler was one of the major players in getting Pendleton listed on the National Register of Historic Places. And Sandy saw this house one day, fell in love with it. She and her husband, Dick, purchased the house. I don't think it had had paint put on it in close to 90 or 100 years. It had been vacant for about 40 years. They came in, restored the house. They've done a wonderful job on it. It has, I believe, 13-foot ceilings on the first floor. It's built by a Colonel Parker, who was a colonel during the Civil War. He came back to Pendleton, purchased this property, built the home. Later, there was a gas boom in the Pendleton area in the 1880s. He drilled a gas well and heated his home quite nicely with a gas well on the back of the property. This home is built by Dr. John Stevenson, approximately 1830. It is a federal style home, 2.5 stories. If you're ever up in the attic of this, it's hard to get around because there's a massive amount of lumber. The lumber in this attic could probably build 2 average style homes or size homes today. This was also the historic headquarters of Pendleton's Historic Fall Creek Pendleton Settlement for a number of years. At one time, they purchased the house to save it and restore it, which they did a wonderful job. Ron Burline, Ruth Burline were both integral in this home and having it saved. Their home is the Gray Goose Inn here in town. It's now owned by Jack and Kathy Tudor, who also care very much for this. They've got offices in here for a number of different businesses, and Jack and Kathy have been members of Historic Fall Creek Pendleton Settlement for a number of years as well. This home was built by Thomas Pendleton, who platted and created the town of Pendleton in the 1820s. Around 1830, he constructed this house for his residence, and it's unusual in that it has two front doors. My guess is one of them would have gone into the parlor, the other door would have led into living spaces in the home. At one time, Charlie Owens purchased this house, and later he willed it to the South Madison Community Foundation. Right now, this is the headquarters of South Madison Community Foundation. This Queen Anne-style home was built in 1904. One of the unique features is the attic stairway on the second floor has 1904 painted on the door. It's grain painted, and it's just amazing that it survived all these years. In the late 1980s, or around 1990 in that period, Helen Reske and Eric Reske saw this home and purchased it, and they did a total restoration. At the time we finished the restoration on the house, Eric approached me and asked me, "Bob, do you think we would have saved money tearing this down and starting over?" I was honest and told him definitely would have saved money, but it wouldn't have been the same by any means. Helen is one of the first the major founders of Historic Fall Creek Pendleton Settlement when she, Ruth Burline, Sandy Butler, and a number of other ladies got together. They got Pendleton listed on the National Register of Historic Places, which is an amazing thing to do. The other town in Indiana that's listed like this is Madison, Indiana. So we have something quite unique here. Their Queen Anne-style home is where they've raised their three sons. In 1937, the Doty family bought this. They raised asparagus and popcorn. Their products were shipped all over the United States. And in the 1930s and 40s, people from Pendleton would walk here. People did a lot of walking in those days. They would purchase popcorn for a nickel a bag, and this was a bag full of corn that you would take home and pop at your own home.
Well, we've seen a lot today. We've gone to the Pendleton Museum, toured homes, looked around Fall Creek Park, saw the site of the massacre of Fall Creek, and all was interesting. We thank everybody from Pendleton to chip in and enjoy. We thank Steve Jackson, who's the Madison County historian, Suzanne Hagee, Judy Tressler, Bob Bilby, Jan Fox, Bob Post, and Kathy Pasco, and of course, Nancy Noel. I hope you've enjoyed this. We've again stepped back in time.